Welcome everyone to our second Lunch and Learn. We're really grateful that everyone's chosen to join us today and to participate. A couple things throughout Dr. Herman's presentation, she is going to have some poll questions that we're gonna put up on the screen. So we'd really appreciate you guys' participation. And then also at the bottom, there is the Q&A button. So if you guys have any questions that come up throughout the presentation, either during when time permits or at the end, we'll do our best to answer all of your guys' questions that you might have. And then just a little bit of background about Dr. Herman. So Dr. Herman is a professor of neurology. She's the vice chair of the Department of Neurology, and she is the director of the Comprehensive Epilepsy Center. And without further ado, I'm gonna turn the floor over to Dr. Herman. And again, thank you everyone for coming.
Great. So thanks everyone for joining us. I'm going to share my screen. Excellent. So what I'm gonna do today is talk about seizure action plans and rescue medications. And this is an important area because prolonged seizures and repetitive seizures can be very dangerous and cause a lot of disruption in people's daily life and can also be quite dangerous and increase the risk for serious illness and even death. So it's very helpful for people to understand what seizure emergencies are and how to deal with them. So most of the people here on the call are gonna know about what seizures and epilepsy are, but I'm gonna start with some brief definitions. So an epileptic seizure is a sudden disruption in brain activity. This is usually temporary, and it's caused by abnormal electrical activity of the brain cells. And this has either unusual symptoms that a person experiences, so unusual sensations or unusual movements, or a change in their ability to interact with the environment. So they may be confused or unresponsive or not be able to remember what's going on during the seizure. Epilepsy is a disorder of the brain that's defined by having repeated seizures, at least two seizures without any clear cause, or at least one seizure with a risk for additional seizures, so that there's either another type of brain injury or a genetic cause, a family history of seizures that makes it likely that that person is going to have additional seizures. And for all practical purposes, that means somebody has a high enough risk of having a second seizure that we would want them to be on a seizure medication. Now there's a lot of different types of seizures. This breaks down into the three main types of seizures that we classify. The first are what we call focal seizures, and these are seizures that begin in one region of the brain. Then there are generalized seizures that come from the whole brain at the same time. And then there are some seizures where we don't actually know where the seizure begins in the brain. That doesn't mean that we can't treat the seizures effectively, but it does mean that we often need to do additional diagnostic testing. So let's talk a little bit more about these different types of seizures, because recognizing different seizure types and what seizures typically look like can be very helpful in determining whether something is a seizure emergency. So focal seizures, again, these begin in one part of the brain, usually start with a warning or an aura. So the person experiences something, either an unusual sensation, a funny feeling in the stomach, seeing or hearing something unusual, having a sudden sense of panic or a sense of deja vu, or involuntary movements, twitching or jerking or stiffening of an arm or a leg or the face. Usually focal seizures will progress to loss of consciousness or confusion or unresponsiveness. The person may have a blank stare and not answer questions. They may have automatic behavior, things like mouth movements, like chewing or lip smacking, picking up things or grabbing things with both hands, sometimes walking around aimlessly. Oftentimes the person has no memory for the seizure, so after it's over, they don't know that it happened. And if they're alone, they may not even know it occurred at all. They need to be told by someone else that the seizure happened. These seizures typically last for 1 to 2 minutes. And after the seizure, the person may have a headache or be confused or sleepy for minutes up to a couple of hours. Now, some focal seizures can spread from that small area of the brain to involve the whole brain. And when that happens, the seizure progresses to what we call a convulsion, where they may make a very loud cry, have stiffening of the body, and then jerking of the arms and legs. They bite their tongue or lose control of their bladder or bowels. And these seizures are usually followed by much longer unresponsiveness and after effects of the seizure that can last for up to hours. Now, generalized seizures usually don't have a warning or an aura. They come out of the blue. There's a sudden loss of consciousness, and often the person will fall. They'll again make a loud cry and have stiffening of the body and then jerking of arms and legs. And again, biting the tongue or losing control of the bladder or bowel may happen. And the person may be unresponsive for, usually unresponsive for, you know, a few minutes up to 5 or 10 minutes, and then may have a headache, confusion, and sleepiness that lasts for hours. Again, it's important to have a good description of what happens in a person's seizures so that you know whether a seizure is longer than normal or more severe than the typical seizure, so that you can decide whether you need to seek emergency help or whether a rescue medication is necessary. Okay, so when we talk about seizure emergencies, there are several different types. The most common are seizures that result in some sort of an injury. So particularly convulsive seizures, so either small seizures that progress to spread to the whole brain, or generalized seizures where the person falls, may result in significant injuries. May fall and hit their head, they may break bones, they may develop cuts or that require stitches or bruising. Sometimes people have injuries to the teeth or the mouth, or may have severe tongue biting that can be a problem. People who have seizures with confusion and automatic movements like grabbing things may be at risk for burning themselves if they're working on a hot stove. They may cut themselves if they're working on, you know, with equipment that has moving parts, etc. Some seizures may be followed by prolonged abnormal behavior after a seizure. So I already said that patients may be unresponsive for a period of time or be confused, but sometimes people can become very agitated after a seizure, struggle or become aggressive because they're not aware of what's going on around them, and they can become very frightened and sort of strike out without really knowing what they're doing. Or people may become very paranoid or have other unusual thoughts after a seizure. And that type of abnormal behavior after a seizure is much more common if the seizures are very prolonged or if people have multiple seizures in a short amount of time. But what we're going to do today is spend most of our time talking about seizure emergencies that are related to the seizures themselves. So seizure clusters, and those are defined as 2 or more seizures in a day, because most people don't have seizures every day. Or for people who have very frequent seizures, more than their usual number of seizures in a day. So oftentimes we'll see that people may, you know, have a seizure a couple of times per week, but during a seizure cluster, they might have 3 seizures in 2 or 3 hours. The other type of seizure emergency are prolonged seizures, and these are seizures that last more than 2 minutes. So most seizures will stop on their own fairly quickly without needing any therapy. For some people tend to have longer seizures, and for those people, then we would worry about a seizure emergency if the seizure lasts longer than usual, so at least 50% longer. So if somebody usually has 5-minute seizures and they have a seizure that lasts more than 7 minutes, then you'd start worrying about that being a seizure emergency. And then the final seizure emergency is something called status epilepticus. And this is a situation where the seizures are really unlikely to stop on their own. This usually requires some medication to be given in order to stop the seizures. And those seizures, status epilepticus is defined as seizures that last for more than 5 minutes. or seizures that occur one after the other without the person waking up in between the seizures. And again, these are associated with a very high risk of complications, and we'll talk more about that in a few minutes. Okay, so we're going to spend a lot of time talking about how to prevent and manage seizure emergencies. And we'll give some practical steps, and then we have something called a seizure action plan that we'll talk a little bit more about, and we can provide copies of the seizure action plan to people if they're interested in that. So the first way to prevent seizure emergencies is to know what is likely to cause your seizures, any seizure triggers, and how to avoid them, and really being careful not to put yourself in a situation where you know a seizure is likely to occur. And we'll talk more about that in a minute. Use a medical alert. So either medical alert, or there are other types of jewelry and applications that you can put on your phone that let other people know that you have a history of seizures or epilepsy and what to do. It can usually list your emergency contacts, a number to call, often who your doctor is, and any other medical problems that you might have. For some people, use of a seizure alert device, there are a few different types of devices. There's alarms that can detect when people are having seizures during sleep. You can use a monitor or an intercom in the house if there's somebody in the house who has seizures, to alert other people in the house that a seizure is happening. And there are some new seizure alert devices, watches and armbands, that can be used to alert other people when you're having a seizure. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about that today because their use is still a little bit controversial. They can be very helpful for some people, but they don't work for everyone, and how well they work in any particular person is difficult to predict. So for some people, they can be very helpful, but it's unclear exactly what people will benefit from those most. The next most important thing is to have a seizure action plan. And this is information about what to do in the situation where you're likely to have a seizure or have already had a seizure. And then talking to your provider about rescue medications, what to do and what medications to take if you have a seizure. All right, so let's talk for a second about seizure triggers. So we're gonna do a little bit of a poll, and can everyone just answer the poll about, do you have any seizure triggers? And we want to just pick your most common seizure trigger. And we'll give about a minute, I think, to figure that out. Okay. Do we have enough people to show the results? Excellent. So about half of you say you don't really recognize any seizure triggers, flashing lights for some, mismedications is a pretty common one, and stress, and in some people, exercise. So this is a pretty typical list. So these are common seizure triggers. So some seizures are what we call reflex seizures, where they happen in response to some sort of change in the environment, most commonly flashing lights or patterns, rapid colors and changing scenes on television or in movies, or sounds, music, speech, other unusual sounds can trigger seizures in some people. Seizures are more likely to happen in some other medical illnesses. So people who have diabetes may be at higher risk for having seizures. Patients may be more likely to have seizures when they have a fever or they're ill, have nausea and vomiting. Alcohol and drugs can also both increase the risk for having seizures. Other medications, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. Missed seizure medications, some people noted that that was a possible trigger, and that's probably one of the most common reasons for seizures in people who are otherwise well controlled. Some people only have seizures while they're sleeping. Other people have seizures when they're suddenly woken up unexpectedly or they have to get up earlier than usual. Sleep deprivation or lack of sleep is a very common seizure trigger. Some women have seizures in relationship to hormones, so either at certain times of their menstrual cycle or if they take birth control pills or other types of hormones to regulate their menstrual cycles. Stress is a really big seizure trigger, and for some people, exercise, although that's pretty uncommon, so it can't be an excuse for not exercising if you have seizures. So I mentioned already that missed seizure medications are a pretty common cause for seizures. Forgetting doses is probably the most common reason for missing medication. But sometimes it's because the instructions are confusing. Seizure medications can be very complicated. And if you don't understand how to take medications, then you need to make sure that you discuss that with your seizure provider. Sometimes we as providers recommend changes in the medications, and that can sometimes result in a seizure. If we're lowering one medication and starting a new medication, there may be a period of time when you're at higher risk for having a seizure. Prescription or pharmacy problems, not being able to get your medications on a regular basis or having difficulty paying for the medications is a common reason for people to miss some doses. Sometimes the person with epilepsy doesn't think they need the medication anymore. They've been seizure-free for a long time, and they decide, you know, maybe I don't need this. I'm gonna try for a few days to not take the medicine and see what happens. Or sometimes they have side effects, and so they stop the medications. And it's really important to know that suddenly stopping seizure medications can actually increase the risk for seizure emergencies. So anytime that you're having problems with medications, please discuss that with your provider rather than just suddenly stopping the medication, which can be quite risky. In other cases, a person may not be able to take medications by mouth. Maybe they have nausea and vomiting from another illness, or maybe they have a surgery scheduled and they can't take medications. And that's a time where you could discuss with your provider what to do in order to prevent a seizure if you're temporarily unable to take your medicines. So about half of people who take a chronic medicine don't take it exactly right all the time. And maybe that's even higher than half of the people. I know I certainly have made mistakes or stopped a prescription before I should have. And if you have to take a medication every day, that can really be a drag. And forgetting medications or occasionally missing doses of medicines is really, really common. Now, most of the time, if you miss one dose of medication, you're not going to have any serious problems. But because seizure medications really only work when the blood level is at a good range, for some people, even missing a single dose of medication can result in a seizure. And that's really going to depend on, you know, what medicine that you're taking, how long it lasts in your system, how many doses you missed, and how big the dose was that you missed, and how severe your epilepsy is. And so not everyone will have a seizure if you miss a dose, but it certainly can happen. And we really want to minimize missed doses because that's the best way to keep people's seizures under control. Now, on the other hand, stopping medications entirely, completely stopping the medicine and not taking it for two or more days often results in breakthrough seizures. And those seizures are much more likely to be severe or prolonged than typical seizures. You know, any of you who have been in the hospital for monitoring of your seizures with video and EEG know that one of the most effective ways for us to produce seizures and figure out where they're coming from in the brain is to stop the seizure medications. So this is a really effective way to cause seizures, and certainly not something that you want to try at home. So these seizures may be more severe or more prolonged, or may even result in seizure clusters or status epilepticus. Sometimes other medications can be a problem. So there can be interactions between other medicines and your seizure medicines. So other medicines can either lower the amount of medicine in your blood, or in rare cases may actually increase the amount of medicine in your blood. And that can result either in a breakthrough seizure if the blood levels of your medicine are too low, or side effects if the blood levels of the seizure medicine are too high. And so for this potential problem, when new medicines are prescribed, you really want to let your provider who's giving the new medication know that you're taking seizure medicine, which seizure medicine you're taking, and that you want to know if there's any possibility of an interaction between the seizure medicine and the new medicine. The second problem with some medicines is that they do what we call lower the seizure threshold. And what that means is that they change the brain in a way that makes it more likely that a seizure will occur. It's not an interaction, it's actually a direct effect on the excitability of the brain. And so when you're taking this medication, you are more likely, maybe more likely to have a seizure than if you weren't taking that second medicine. And there is a really long list of medicines that can do this. Some of the common ones are certain types of antibiotics, some medicines for depression, some medicines for cold and flu, some herbs or supplements, and some birth control. Now, none of these are, you know, every single medicine that's an antibiotic. That's, you know, it's certain types of antibiotics. But this is just to give you an idea of some of the types of medicines that can be a problem. And again, just make sure that whoever's prescribing you a new medicine knows that you're taking a seizure medicine, that you have epilepsy. And if you have any concerns about whether the new medicine might cause a problem, talk to the person who, to the provider who treats your epilepsy. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the different types of seizure emergencies. So the first are what we call seizure clusters. There's a lot of different names for this phenomenon. Sometimes they're called serial seizures or recurrent seizures or repetitive seizures. Typically, seizure clusters last, you know, 30 minutes or sometimes up to a couple of hours. And these are seizures that occur one after the other. But in between the seizures, the person wakes up, is able to respond, is potentially even able to take a rescue medication or to let somebody else know that they've had a seizure. And we look for a change in the seizure pattern. So either an increase in the severity of the seizures, an increase in the frequency of the seizures, or an increase in duration. And as I said before, clusters can last several minutes, up to several hours, or even for a whole day. So how common is this? About half of people who have epilepsy will have at least one seizure cluster at some point in their life. And for people who've had more than four seizures, who typically have more than four seizures in a year, about three quarters of them will have a seizure cluster. And this is important because once you've had one seizure cluster, you're likely to have more. And seizure clusters can be quite disruptive. They can require emergency room visits or hospitalizations. They increase the risk of breathing and heart problems after a seizure. They can prolong the time for recovery after a seizure, so cause problems with memory, mood, or behavior. And more than half of seizure clusters can progress to status epilepticus, which is a true seizure emergency, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So status epilepticus is continuous seizures that last for more than 5 minutes, or repeated seizures where the person doesn't wake up in between the seizures. And we used to allow 30 minutes of continuous seizures before we would call it status epilepticus, but over the last 10 to 15 years, we've recognized that almost all seizures will stop within 2 to 3 minutes. And so if a seizure gets to the point of 5 minutes, it's unlikely to stop on its own and should be treated with a rescue medication to prevent more serious complications. And status epilepticus is very common. Between 60 and 125,000 people in the United States have status epilepticus every year. Not every person who has status epilepticus has a diagnosis of epilepsy. But what about people who do have epilepsy? How likely are they to have status epilepticus? So about 15% of people with a diagnosis of epilepsy will have at least one episode of status epilepticus. And once you've had one, you're likely to have more. So it increases your risk for having additional episodes. And as I mentioned, status epilepticus is a medical emergency. It significantly increases the risk of breathing and heart problems. It usually requires hospitalization and often intensive care, may even require placement of a breathing tube and use of a ventilator to support your breathing for a period of time. And unfortunately, between 3 and 5% of people who have status epilepticus may die. This is people who have epilepsy who develop status epilepticus, either because the seizures can't be controlled with medicines or because of complications of the seizures or of the treatment. And if this status epilepticus is very difficult to control, the risk of death can be very, very high, nearly 50%. So this is a pretty rare complication, but it's common enough that every person with epilepsy should know about this risk and should be prepared to take action if they have an unusual seizure that could progress to status epilepticus so that they never get to this point of the medical emergency. And then we had also talked about prolonged or abnormal behavior after seizures. And these behavior problems are more common if somebody has had a seizure cluster or a prolonged seizure or status epilepticus. So after a typical seizure, people may be unresponsive or confused for, 10, 15, maybe 30 minutes, and they may have headaches or muscle aches, confusion, memory problems, trouble with speech, difficulty with balance and weakness that can last hours up to days. But in people who have seizure clusters or status epilepticus, sometimes they have continuing seizures. So they may be unresponsive with just a little bit of twitching or some funny movements of the face or the eyes, or they may just be confused and not returning to their normal behavior. And when that happens, you really want to look for emergency help to make sure that the person isn't continuing to have small seizures that are causing the confusion. Another reason for abnormal behavior after a seizure is if a rescue medication was used, sometimes the side effects of that rescue medication can be confusion or disorientation or sleepiness. So it can be really difficult to tell whether something is a side effect or an after effect of a seizure. So our general rule of thumb is if the person hasn't returned to their usual behavior within 15 minutes or so of the seizure, then that's time to call for emergency help. All right, so the next question is, are you at risk for seizure emergencies? Or is the person with epilepsy at risk? So what are some of the things that increase the likelihood that somebody will have a seizure emergency? So the most important one is, have you ever had a seizure emergency before? Have you had seizure clusters or very long seizures or status epilepticus at any point in your life? That increases the risk. And if that happened within the past year, then that's a much higher risk. And we recommend that people who have had previous seizure emergencies have a discussion with their seizure provider to make sure that they know ways to avoid seizure emergencies and how to treat seizure emergencies. Other risks include taking large numbers of seizure medications. So people who take two or more seizure medications are at higher risk, or sorry, more than two, so that's three or more, Or if you've tried multiple medications that haven't fully controlled your seizures, what we call drug refractory or drug resistant epilepsy. If you often miss doses of your medicines, we talked before about how missed doses, particularly multiple missed doses, can really increase the risk for seizure emergencies. If your seizures are serious enough that you've had to have epilepsy surgery or another device to treat your seizures, or if you have a small number of specific types of epilepsy, some epilepsies that have a genetic cause or some types of epilepsy that have specific types of seizures are much more likely to cause seizure clusters and status epilepticus. So again, these are a list of questions that you can discuss with your provider to see whether you are personally at risk for seizure emergencies. All right, so we're gonna start now and take another poll. And we're gonna switch gears and talk a little bit about a seizure action plan. So the poll is, do you have a seizure action plan? I guess we should have added an option of, I don't know what a seizure action plan is. Should be pretty quick for people to fill out, I think. All right, I think we can close that poll. Only 13% of people have a seizure action plan. So that is disappointing, but not unexpected. Because many people don't know that a seizure action plan is a good idea. They may not know that they are at risk for seizure emergencies, or they may think that they know what to do if they have a seizure, but have never really discussed it formally with the person who takes care of them for their seizures. So we're going to talk a little bit about seizure action plans and what they're for. So a seizure action plan is a written plan of what to do in case of a seizure. And usually it's divided into what to do if you experience a seizure trigger and you think you're at risk for having a seizure, what to do in that case, what to do if you have the warning for a seizure, what to do after you've had a seizure in terms of first aid and whether you need to take medications, and then what to do if you have a seizure emergency, if the seizures are longer or more frequent than usual, if the seizures don't stop on their own, or if the person doesn't return to usual behavior. And seizure action plans are usually developed together with the person, the provider who takes care of your seizures, so that you both understand what to do in each of these situations. So what's in a seizure action plan? The first is usually about your epilepsy team, who's involved in the care of your seizures. So that would be you, how to get in touch with you, name, address, phone, cell phone, the name and contact information for anyone who is a caregiver for you, any emergency contacts, who you want to be notified in the event of an emergency, either family or friends, your primary care provider, your epilepsy provider, either your, you know, neurologist or your epilepsy specialist, and then which hospital, emergency room, or urgent care center you'd like to be taken to if you have a seizure, and then information on your where you get your medications, your pharmacy. And so this is a seizure action plan that we've developed in conjunction with the Epilepsy Foundation and the Epilepsy Learning Healthcare System. It starts off with information that this is a plan for the treatment of seizure emergencies, and that you've discussed it with your doctor and their staff, and that if you experience a seizure emergency and you need to go to the emergency room or be hospitalized, you ask that the team at that hospital contact the people who take care of your epilepsy to talk about how to manage the seizure emergency. And then there's information about you, your caregiver, your emergency contacts, and then your epilepsy provider, your primary care provider, your hospital, and your pharmacy. So that all of this information is in one place. You can carry it with you, or hopefully at some point we'll have a form that, you know, you can be on your cell phone and an app so that you'd be able to access this information whenever it's needed. All right, so the next information is information about your seizures, what the name of the seizure is, so what you call it, and also what your healthcare provider calls it. So you may call it a small seizure, and your healthcare provider may call it a focal aware seizure, so a seizure that comes from part of the brain where you're fully awake during the seizure. Or you call it falling down seizure, and your provider may call it a generalized tonic-clonic seizure. You also want to know how long the seizure lasts, how often the seizures occur, and a description of what happens during the seizure. And so in the seizure action plan, we have this information on the next page. So my seizure types, what the seizure is called, what you call it, and what your provider calls it, how long it lasts in seconds or minutes, how often they typically occur, and then exactly what happens during the seizure. Next, we want information about what medicines you take for your seizures on a daily basis, the name of the medicine, how much you take, and then when you take it and how much you take at each dose. So here's another chart to put that information down. So the daily seizure medicines, this person's taking Lamictal extended release, the brand. She's taking either 200 or 300 milligram tablets, and at each time she takes 800 milligrams once a day. And then we have other information. Are there any triggers for the seizures? Are there any warning signs or aura signs? Is there other important medical history? Any allergies to medicines? Any previous surgery or devices or diet therapy for the seizures? And then any other notes that you think might be important for somebody to know about your epilepsy. Okay, so then the next section of the form is about first aid for seizures. And some of these things apply to anyone having a seizure. So the first is stay safe inside. And there's a great brochure from the Epilepsy Foundation on this, and you can download it and actually use it as a screensaver on your phone if you want to have something to check on in the event of an emergency. So the first thing is to stay calm during the seizure and begin timing the seizure and observing what happens. If you're witnessing the seizure, if you're the person experiencing the seizure, you may be able to call out for help or let somebody know that you're having the beginning of a seizure so that they can help you. The next thing is to keep the person safe, move things around from around the patient so that they don't get injured, try to help them to sit or to lie down on the ground if they're still standing at the time that the seizure is happening. Don't hold people down during a seizure because that can increase the risk of injury or cause people to be agitated, and then put something under the person's head so that they are at lower risk for injury. If you can, during the seizure, turn them on their side. And this is mostly for big seizures where somebody is having a convulsion, stiffening and shaking of their whole body. So turn them on their side if they're not awake. Keep things away from their mouth and their nose so that they don't have difficulty breathing. But don't put anything in the person's mouth. So I mentioned before that people may bite their tongue during a seizure. That actually can't be prevented. And the jar is very, very strong. And people may have serious injuries to their teeth or their gums if you put anything into their mouth. In addition, it may actually cause them to choke or to block off the airway so that they have more difficulty with breathing. So you really want to keep the mouth and the nose clear and not put anything in the mouth. And then stay with the person who's had the seizure until they're fully recovered. notify the emergency contact if you have that information. For some people who have devices like a vagus nerve stimulator or another type of device, you may swipe the magnet for that device in order to either treat or record the seizures. And then for somebody who's seeing the seizure, you want to try to write down what happens. So describe each seizure, what occurs, how long it lasts, how many seizures there were. And then if there's a prescription for rescue medications, start to give that rescue medicine. And again, there's a couple of links here. We can make these slides available to everybody on the epilepsy.com, Epilepsy Foundation website about this information. And there's actually a first aid certification for seizures that you can do and actually take a test to demonstrate that you understand what to do for first aid for seizures. Okay, the next part of the action plan is, when should you call your provider? When should you let your doctor or nurse know that you've had a seizure? And this would be for any change in seizure type, number, or pattern. If you haven't had a seizure in a long time and you suddenly have a seizure, then you may want to call them if you have any seizure. If you've had any of these seizure emergencies, so seizure clusters or prolonged seizures or repeated seizures, definitely let your provider know. If you have to use a rescue medication, and sometimes the provider may want to know every time you use a rescue medicine, sometimes they'll only want to know if you use more than 3 or 4 or 5 rescue medications in a month, just so they can keep tabs on how you're doing. Generally, you're going to want to let your provider know if you've had any emergency room visits or hospitalizations for seizures, or if you have a seizure that's different from your usual seizure. The next is when to call 911. When is something in need of emergency medical attention? So usually seizures with loss of consciousness that last for more than 5 minutes, you would call for emergency help. And if you have a rescue medication and you're giving the rescue medicine and the seizure lasts for 5 minutes after the rescue medicine is given, then you definitely need to call for emergency help. If you have repeated seizures, so your provider may say, if you have more than 2 seizures in 24 hours or more than 3 seizures in 8 hours, you should call for emergency help. And this is very individualized. It really is going to depend on what kind of seizures you have and how often you typically have seizures. So all of these things that are in red here are things that you and your doctor would plan together to say, you know, this is when I need to call 911. It's very specific to your situation. For people who have rescue medications, if the seizures continue for more than a certain number of minutes after the rescue medicine, call 911. If there's any difficulty breathing, if there's prolonged changes in behavior after a seizure, if the person becomes injured or a seizure occurs in water, or if the person with the seizure is pregnant, then you definitely want to call 911. Better safe than sorry in those situations. The seizure action plan then often includes what to do after a seizure. So what kind of help is the person likely to need? When can they go back to their usual activities? If you have to call for emergency services, what should the emergency services do? Are there certain medications that could be given? And then if you have to go to the emergency room, what could be done in the emergency room? So again, going back to our seizure action plan, this is broken down into the first aid information, when to call your provider, when to call 911, what to do after a seizure, and what to do for special situations where you end up in the hospital. And for each of these, we kind of check off which ones apply to the person with epilepsy. So these can be really individualized and be appropriate for your type of epilepsy and your type of seizures. Sometimes we can have information for specific situations, so what to do if a seizure occurs at work, or what to do if a seizure occurs at school or in a day program, either for young children or for elderly people who may be in a program during the day. What to do if the person, you know, who's with the patient is not their parents? What if there's a babysitter or another caregiver? You know, what to do in those situations? And having all of this information written down can be really, really helpful to make sure that everyone understands what typical seizures are like and when things are becoming a potential emergency. All right, so now we're going to move into rescue medicines. And this is a really complicated topic. We're not going to be able to make specific recommendations on, you know, what's the right rescue medication for you. But what we should be able to do is give an overview so that you can have an open discussion with your provider about whether you should have a rescue medicine and what type might be useful. So the seizure action plan usually includes information about when to give the medicine, and I'll give you more details about this. After what type of seizure, the name of the medicine, the dose, how to give it, and then what to do if the seizure doesn't stop. And I'll again show you the seizure action plan to just give you an example of that. So for this person, they have two different rescue medications. The first is a medicine that they take by mouth, and it's 1 milligram tablets. And they take this medicine if they have any aura, if they have any seizure warning that makes it seem like they're likely to have a seizure. They would take 1 milligram of this and place that under the tongue until it's dissolved, and only be given if the person is awake. And if the seizure, if they have another seizure or the aura lasts for more than 5 minutes, then they give a second dose. Now, if they have a seizure cluster, so more than one seizure in 24 hours, or a seizure lasting more than 5 minutes, or two or more seizures without waking up, then they take this second medicine called Nasalam. It's 5 milligrams. This is a nasal spray. They give one spray into one nostril, and I'll give you more instructions on this. Put the tip into the nostril and press the plunger. And if the seizure continues, give a second dose of the rescue medicine. And then the final part of the rescue plan is how to monitor the person after the rescue medicine. And we'll come back to that in a minute. So you can see that this can be really complicated. And if you don't have it written down, then it's really unlikely that you'll be able to do this without making any mistakes. And for someone else who doesn't know as much about your seizures, it may be nearly impossible to use the rescue medications in the most effective way. So having this written down is incredibly important. So why are rescue medicines helpful? So they may completely prevent a seizure. So if somebody has a trigger, you know, maybe they were up all night or they've had nausea and vomiting and they feel like they're really at risk for having a seizure, a rescue medicine may be able to prevent a seizure in that situation. In some cases, it may shorten a seizure. If it can be given during the seizure, they may be able to stop the seizure in the middle and shorten the time that it takes to recover after a seizure. It may prevent you from needing an emergency room visit or needing to call 911. And most importantly, it may prevent status epilepticus and the risks associated with that. Now, there's several different types of rescue medications available. And again, this is a discussion that you need to have based on your own individual situation. But the main factors that we would consider are the type of medicine. Is it one of your typical seizure medicines, or is it a special medicine for seizure clusters or emergencies? How well does it work? How likely is it to stop a seizure? How long does it last? Is this something that's going to work for 2 hours or 4 hours or 24 hours to prevent more seizures? How often can you take the medicine? What are the potential side effects, both the common side effects as well as potential serious side effects? How easy is it to use? Does somebody else need to be there to give you the medicine, or can you use it yourself? How is it given? Is it a pill? Is it a spray? Is it an injection? Is it a rectal medicine? Can you carry it with you? It's hard to carry liquids around with you. Does it need to be refrigerated so it's hard to, you know, to keep with you at all times? how long before it expires. Is it 6 months, a year, 2 years before you need to replace it? Remember, you're not likely to need this often, but it needs to be not expired when you do need it. And then how expensive is it? And is it covered by your insurance? Rescue medicines can include extra doses of your usual medications, but most commonly they're a group of medications called benzodiazepines, and these can be given by mouth, orally, rectally into the rectum, intranasally as a nasal spray, sublingual, which is under the tongue, buccal, which is into the cheek between the teeth and the gums, intramuscular, which is an injection into the muscle, or intravenous, which is injection into the vein. And these last two are usually done either by emergency personnel or once you get to the emergency room or hospital. So the medicines that can be given by mouth include both liquid forms and pill forms. So these are all benzodiazepines, lorazepam, diazepam, midazolam, and then pills of lorazepam and diazepam, and a disintegrating tablet, clonazepam, which kind of is a very loose pill that dissolves in the mouth. And these pills are generally placed under the tongue so that they'll dissolve and be absorbed quickly into your bloodstream. So you don't swallow these. These generally go into the mouth and get absorbed right through the mouth into your system. The downsides of these are that often they need to be refrigerated. It may be difficult, particularly for the liquid medications, to prepare them during an emergency. You need to pull them up into a syringe and get the person in the right position to give the medication. They may take longer to have an effect, particularly if the person isn't able to cooperate and get the pill under their tongue or easily into their cheek. And you might not even be able to give it during a seizure because of the risk of choking. If the person isn't awake, then it's risky to put something in their mouth like a pill in the middle of a seizure. So the next medication is a rectal medication. This is a medicine called diazepam, rectal diazepam gel, under a brand name Diastat. This works very quickly, usually within 5 minutes. It has various doses depending on the age of the person with seizures, but you don't need to worry too much about that because it comes in something called an AccuDial that has the right dose for that person with epilepsy. The medication is given into the rectum, and side effects are potential sleepiness, breathing problems, allergy, or rash. So what are some of the downsides of this? I already said that it's quite effective and for many, many years was the standard of care for treating seizure emergencies, but it might be difficult to give it during a seizure to get the person into the right position. You need to take their pants off in order to give the medication. It can be very embarrassing and may not be able to be done in public because of, you know, the need for how the medicine is given into the rectum. That can be very off-putting, particularly for adults. They're often reluctant to consider a rectal medication as an option, even though it's a very effective medication and can really prevent complications of long seizures. And this is just an example from one of the initial trials of this diazepam rectal medicine compared to a sugar rectal medicine, what we call a placebo. And you can see that for patients who got the placebo, most of them continued to have seizures over time. So by the time they get to 24 hours, almost everyone had additional seizures. Only 20% of people stopped having seizures spontaneously. Whereas the people who got diazepam, you can see within just a few hours, within about 4 hours, the seizures were controlled. And so this was very clearly a good way to stop seizure emergencies and seizure clusters. Now, recently, there have been two new medications that have come out for seizure clusters. Both of them are nasal sprays. The first is called Nasalam. This is a midazolam nasal spray. And all of these words here basically mean that it can be given to people 12 years or older who have seizure clusters. either during the cluster or after a seizure, during a seizure or after a seizure within a cluster. The person doesn't need to be awake and cooperative or breathe in like an asthma inhaler. You can just spray the medication. If the person is awake, they can give the medications to themselves, but during a seizure, they may need somebody to give it to them. And it's 5 milligrams. The spray goes into one nostril. If you have another seizure within 10 minutes, after 10 minutes, you can do another spray into the other nostril. And you can use it up to once every 3 days with a maximum of 5 per month. Common side effects of this are breathing problems. So the person should be monitored after the seizure for breathing. Any sleepiness, mood changes or thoughts of hurting oneself. Some people get a little panicky or anxious, may have a headache, may have some irritation of the nose or the throat. If this medicine is used too often, it can cause dependence and withdrawal if you suddenly stop the medication, and it shouldn't be used if you have a specific type of glaucoma. And this is the nasal spray. So basically it comes in a little plastic cartridge. You take it out and basically put your fingers around the this part, and then use your thumb to press the plunger. You don't do that until the tip of this is in the nose, and then you depress the plunger and give the medication directly into the nose. The other new medication is Valtoco, and this is another nasal spray, but this is diazepam. It's used for the same type of seizure emergencies, but for this, it can be used down to age 6, and it can be used either during a seizure or after a seizure. Again, the dosing is weight-based. This often requires 2 sprays, 1 into each nostril, and you can repeat it after 4 hours if the person has another seizure. Side effects are almost identical to the side effects of the midazolam nasal spray, and the cartridge looks very similar. So after a rescue medicine is given, if the person continues to have seizures, then you need to call 911. You need to stay with the person and make sure that they're waking up appropriately. If they have any breathing problems or other complications, you also may need to call 911. And the person who received the rescue medicine shouldn't do anything that requires a lot of coordination or working with machinery with moving parts or things that require a lot of, you know, mental alertness, because they may feel a little sleepy or clumsy after the rescue medicine for 4 hours or so. There can be some serious side effects. These are typically rare, but they include breathing problems. You might want to consider having somebody in the home learn CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, in case there's any breathing problems. Your provider will talk to you about how to monitor breathing. Sleepiness, rarely low blood pressure or a weak pulse, an allergic reaction, which can be either a rash or hives or swelling of the face or throat, or wheezing or shortness of breath, and then thoughts of harming oneself or suicide. More common are dizziness, sleepiness, trouble with memory or attention, balance problems, headaches, slurred speech, irritability, depression, anxiety, other behavior problems. And these are usually temporary, last maybe, you know, half an hour up to a few hours, and then resolve once the medicine is out of the system. Now, rescue medications can be habit forming. Benzodiazepines are medications that can cause dependence or addiction if they're used very frequently. So you don't want to use more than your provider prescribes for you. And they're certainly not meant to be used on a daily basis. We recommend no more than 5 times in a month. If you or your caregiver think you need rescue medicines more often, you need to talk to your provider about that. And then using these medicines in combination with alcohol or other medications that can affect breathing or alertness, particularly pain medications like opiates, can be really dangerous and needs to be avoided. All right, so in summary, preventing seizure emergencies is to know what your triggers are and try to avoid them. Use a medic alert and make sure that people around you know what to do if you have a seizure. have a seizure action plan, work on it with your provider, and make sure everyone that is involved in your care knows where the seizure action plan is and how to use it. Talk to your provider about rescue medications and whether they're a good option for you. And if so, then learn how to use them and recognize when they should be given. All right, thank you very much. I think we can take some questions if people have questions now. If you have a question, you can either type it into the system. I don't think we can unmute anyone. So I finally want to thank all of our sponsors who generously provided support for us to develop this conference and to do the webinars. We would love to get feedback from the people who attended. So let us know if you thought that this was useful or if there's any other information that you need.
I see that Dr. Gupta has his hand raised. So if you could please type your question in the Q&A and then we would be happy to do our best to answer it. Dr. Herman, so he said, what about the dietary therapies in epilepsy?
Yeah, so dietary therapies can be very useful, particularly for patients whose seizures have not responded well to medications. And they include the ketogenic diet, which is a very high fat and almost zero sugar diet, as well as the modified Atkins diet and something called the low glycemic index diet. Those are much easier to follow than the ketogenic diet, and we'll be having a whole session on dietary therapies in a month or two. I'm not sure if that's the next one or the one in July, but we'll certainly make sure that we provide information about that. And we do have a nutritionist from our center who will be participating in that and can give more details about the diet. So whether we should start dietary therapy early in treatment, in kids, that's certainly a consideration for certain types of epilepsy. In adults, we usually think about dietary therapies once somebody has failed two or more seizure medications. Excellent. Well, thank you very much, all of you, for your attention, and we hope that you join us for our next sessions in June and July. So nutrition and epilepsy is the next topic. June 9th, Stephanie Burhop, who's our dietitian, is going to be running that session. Thanks, everyone.